Good morning to all of you. And thank you for being with me in this TED talk this morning. The topic of the talk, as you can see here, is learning versus teaching. To begin with, I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Abhyanand. And as with all of you, I too had the opportunity of going to a school, later to a college, and then I was fortunate enough to get a job very early in my life, immediately after graduating, the job of a cop. Did my job well as a cop to finally head the department, that is the police, a designation called the Director General of Police, Bihar, big state in a country called India. But then, that is me as a cop. I'm sure by now you'll be wondering as to what is a cop doing in a TED talk, and that too, talking on learning and teaching. Well, I'll put it in a very brief way and very simply. Somewhere along the line in my life, I got very seriously involved in teaching and learning process of my two children, right from, let's say, class 1 till they finally got admitted, to both of them, to the best technological institute, I would say definitely of India, and I won't be far off the mark if I also say the world, the Indian Institute of Technology. That made me learn a lot of things, because as I said in my introduction, I was never a trained teacher in any way. Professionally, no. Training, no. But then I learned through my experiences and my experiments which I tried on my children. I wouldn't hesitate to say that both of them acted as guinea pigs for me insofar as learning and teaching is concerned. After they got into the IIT, I was left without a job, except the job that I had in hand, and that was going after criminals as a cop. So, and I had enough time with me, because once you reach to the top, you do a lot of cerebral work and less of physical work. So I decided to do an experiment in society, that is, pick up 30 students, all very talented, very poor, can't afford coaching, and guide them to get into the IIT. In the process, again, as I said, with my children and with these guys, this experiment went on, and the concepts that I developed about what is learning and how is it different from teaching, or how are the two related, and what should we do, what should we be doing with our children of the next generation, those got consolidated. In this TED talk, I intend to share some of my experiences. I'll draw my own conclusions, and you are free to draw your own conclusions, because I have not been doing any empirical work by way of research on what is teaching and what is learning. It was all through experience, which I'll share with you some of them. There are a lot many more. So to begin with, this was the first event. I'll very briefly recount that event. It may not be of much interest, but it will add some color to the talk. Class 1, my child, I come back home from office, tired, and then I find that my son is having a fight with his mother. Or is the other way around. The mother is scolding the son, because he gets a 0 out of 10 in a class test which demanded single digit multiplication. All wrong. I called him over and I said, "Why did you get it all wrong?" The blunt answer was, "My miss wants me to memorize tables and I won't." Now, this is an answer which put me on the back foot completely, because I was not expecting this answer from a child of class 1. I had gone through the same process. I had to learn my tables to do multiplication. And this guy says, no, I'm not going to learn multiplication tables. But it set me thinking. So I asked a question. Okay, forget about multiplication table. Do you understand what numbers are? 5, 6, 9, 10, 11, whatever. He said, yes, I do. The next question, which came very spontaneously to my mind, I do not know from where, was, okay, if you understand what numbers are, tell me which is the biggest number in this world. And that set him thinking. He did not give me an answer like infinity. And if he had, I would have thought it was garbage in and garbage out. So he says, okay, you are making me a fool. I said, why? There cannot be such a big number. That put me thinking even more. So what went on in his mind which made him give me this answer? And he says, and I asked him very promptly, why? And his answer was, you give me such a number, I'll add one to it. And gentlemen, that was the turning point in my life as far as my journey into guiding my children and my journey into teaching these 30 guys. It was a turning point. That gave me the first light into what is actually learning. And I'll give you my impression after I've gone through a few more questions, although there are many more, but those will be very illustrative examples of how I reach my conclusions and how I keep refining my conclusions with every passing day. The next incident, this was class 2. The guy, I'm talking about my son, he was going off to sleep. At that moment, you know that your mind is not in the best agile form. I asked him, can you do a problem for me? He said, yes, boliye. I said, add all the numbers from 1 to 99, all the positive integers. And he took about a minute. It was all very mental. And he says, I'll give you the answer, 4950. And when I looked at the answer, I had not calculated it. And believe me, I didn't have any way of doing it except my formula, which I had learned. When I put it in the formula, I said, yes, you guy is right. How did you figure this out? And he said, 1 to 99, I put them all in a row. 99 and 1, 2 and 98, 49 pairs of hundreds, or 50 in middle, no pair. So 49 hundreds and a 50 is 4950. Now this was class 2. Then I remembered an incident which I had read about Gauss. And he had also done it something very similarly. I thought my son was going to a good school. Maybe he knows things better. But I have tried this in rural areas of Bihar where children have had no schooling at all. For their age, they would have been going to class 2, class 3. And some of them have been able to solve it in this way, in some other way, maybe a third way. This was my second experience, and I keep experiencing it wherever I go, especially areas where children have had no exposure to very good schooling, the typically very good schooling. Coming to the third. This was class 6, when children have already learned something about fractions and ratios, and they understand the sense of ratio is there with them. Before going to office, I gave them a problem. It was summer holidays for them. And I gave them that problem. I said, you draw a right angle triangle like this and make it keep becoming bigger and bigger. And then find out the ratio every time. Measure it on the scale. Then use the calculator to find out the ratio, and you'll observe something. Give me that observation when I come back from office. And I'd like to know the reason why. Why this observation? Why is this happening? The two children, my daughter and my son, they sat down together. They worked the whole day trying to measure it on scale and then measuring it, taking it out on the calculator. And when I came back, they were quite excited. They said, Papa, the ratios always remain the same. The triangles can become bigger and bigger, but the ratios will remain the same. The triangles are becoming bigger, but the angle remains the same. And therefore, this ratio has to do something with the angle, because that is the only thing which is common to all the triangles. This is another problem which I have tried with my two children, and also with children in the rural areas, class 2 to class 6. And I have found that I have never failed in getting an answer, not from everyone, but from people who are sharp. This is the rural areas of Bihar. The problem was, as this suggests, handshake problem. 10 children come out, each of you shake hand with the other, and how many handshakes are there? Only once. A with B, B with A is the same as A with B. I made it very clear. And I recount that experience of rural Bihar, where is the so-called Naxal affected district, very popularly known, and people don't go to school, hardly any school out there. And I was there for a police job with policemen all around me, but it's my habit of gathering rural children and in any age of children group, gather them together, give them a problem and see how they react to it. In fact, when I gave this problem, I found that the district superintendent of police muttering into my ears, he is an ITN, he said, "Sir, 12th mein padhate hain, what are you doing here with these guys?" I said, "This is an experiment, let's see what happens." And one smart guy, he came out, he said, "Sir, I'll do it." Of course, he was talking in the local dialect, which I could understand. He made all 10 of them stand together in a line, walked out himself, shook hands with 9 of them, counting out loud, says, "Sir, ye 9 hua." I said, "Is that over?" I said, "No." "Then this next man will come out." And he said, "Inka bhi 9 hoga, he'll also do 9 handshakes." I said, "Don't you think you're committing a mistake here?" He looked at me for a while, I think it was half a minute, and says, "Yes, sir. My handshake with him is over, so that will not be counted. It will only be 8. And I remind you, gentlemen, this is a village where children are not going to school. They have not seen the school phase. For their age, they should have been going to class 2. They know counting. And he counted on his fingers 9 and 8 and 7 and a 6 to 1. Counted, he said 45. I turned to the ITN and I said, "Put it in your formula and see whether it is true or not." And his spontaneous reaction was astonished. "Sir, ye to bina formula ka kar sakta hai." I said, "The man who had developed this won't be having the formula. So he had developed it all by himself." And children have the raw talent. For every generation, they'll always have talent to develop their own logic. So these are issues which I have debated in my mind and which I have experimented with both urban and rural children. And as I said in the beginning, I have got my own conclusions. You will also be left free to draw your conclusions about your children and the next generation too. Now I come to the end of the talk. What did I learn? And I tell you, gentlemen, I have a definition of a teacher which I apply to myself. Even today, every day I teach. So that was an aside. A teacher, in my opinion, is one who rarely gives the right answer, but who always keeps asking the right question. And the last thing that I would like to add here, through all my experiences, and as I said many times, and I'll repeat it again, those are only few of the illustrations. All of them, unfortunately, from mathematics, because I think mathematics is the only subject, I prefer to call it a language, which teaches you logic and thinking, and thinking very rationally. It's a wonderful language. The thing is, keep challenging the mind of your children. The more you challenge them, the more you participate in the solution to problems, become a participant with him, keep him challenging, make his mind a processor and not only a gatherer of information, which unfortunately we are doing very often. You have quizzes and quizzes, and which is like, if I know an information, I am not able to use that information, what good is it? And the internet is a, you know, a source, is a repository of lot of information. So this is a very small mind that we have here. This mind has been created by God to process information and not to make it a store of information. Thank you very much.